This is Thursday, July 16th, 2015. We are in Natick, Massachusetts, and this tape is part of the Morse Institute Library's continuing Veterans Oral History Project. My name is Maureen Sullivan. Our cameraman is Dan McDermott of Natick Pegasus. And we are privileged to have with us today Russ Lattuca. Welcome, Russ.
Thank you very much.
May I ask when you were born?
September 22nd, 1947.
And where were you born?
Concord, Massachusetts.
And where were you raised?
In Maynard, Mass.
And what community do you currently live in?
I live in Natick.
Your marital status?
Widowed.
And do you have children?
Yes, I do. Two. Boy and a girl.
Grandchildren?
None.
Tell us what Maynard was like growing up.
Again, it was a small town that, typical probably of any small town in Massachusetts, with the one exception of the fact that Digital Equipment Corporation started there. It started in a garage not too far from the downtown area and then expanded worldwide. And so basically everybody that lived in Maynard either worked there at one time or knew somebody or had a family member that worked there. So it was quite the place.
And your family was no exception.
Right. My mother worked there for a while, and so it was one of those things where, like I say, everybody either knew someone or worked there themselves.
And you graduated from Maynard High.
Graduated from Maynard High in 1965.
And did you join the Navy, enlisted,
drafted? Yeah, I enlisted. Actually, I was speaking with the recruiter prior to my graduation. And basically, I signed up before I graduated. And then I told him I wanted the summer off for whatever reason. I'm not quite sure at the, you know, what I did was so important. But I ended up going into the service to boot camp in September.
And why the Navy?
Well, my father was in the Army, and I saw pictures of him, you know, sleeping on the ground in a tent, you know, and it didn't appeal to me. And I said, the Navy seems, at least you have a clean bunk, you have three meals a day. And so I went with the Navy.
All right, so this is 1965. You've
Yes.
just enlisted into the Navy. What was the situation in the United States at that time?
Well, there was a war going on, and a lot of people thought I might have been a little crazy to join the service at that time. Some people expressed it verbally. But that really wasn't the reason I joined. I mean, I wasn't like, you know, politically active or anything like that, you know, gung-ho, you know, get over there and do whatever you have to do. I just didn't want to. A lot of my friends actually that graduated from high school at the same time I did went to college. I just didn't feel like I wanted to go to college, or I wasn't ready to go to college at the time. So then I joined into service.
So where were you sent for basic?
Basic was Great Lakes, Illinois.
And was this the first time you were away from Maynard?
Yes, it was. It was a little of a bit of a shock, I'd say. You know, I never really went anywhere, never traveled anywhere, so it was the first plane ride anywhere. We left Logan late at night. We ended up getting into Chicago really early in the morning. They transported us to the base. We ended up getting about 2 hours sleep. You know, they wake you up at 4 o'clock or whatever it was, and that was my initiation to the U.S. Navy.
And was this the first time you were in a group with people from other parts
Yes,
of the country?
Definitely. Yeah, it was an eye opener because, like you say, there were people from all over the country, and it was different.
So tell us what basic was like besides getting woken up at 4 a.m.
Well, you know, basic training basically brought you into the service, and it taught you, you know, to respect officers, you know, to do things the Navy way. You were marched everywhere. You know, that was one of the big things. You had to either you were marching in a group or you were running. by yourself. There was no walking anywhere during boot camp. You know, you were taught a lot of things. One of the, you know, cleanliness, you were taught anything about the service. I mean, the Navy, I mean, basically, you know, you tried to learn everything in general about the Navy itself, the history of the Navy, and what your role might be on the ship, not just your particular job, but you had other things that you may have to do, and so like firefighting, things like that.
Did you develop an interest in any one particular skill set?
Well, actually, when I signed up initially, when I spoke with the recruiter, I said that I'd like to get into some type of electronics field. And so he said, well, we'll see what we can do. And so luckily, after boot camp, that's when they sent me to Fire Control Technician A School, which is in Bainbridge, Maryland. And there you learned electricity and electronics and radar for shipboard use.
So when were you sent to Maryland?
Basically, after boot camp, you were given 2 weeks off, and then from there you just went right to school.
So I'm assuming that if you went to basic in September,
right,
and it's usually like 12 weeks?
It was something like that, right.
Did you get home in time for Christmas?
I believe I did.
Okay.
And, you know, unfortunately that's a little fuzzy.
That's but, okay.
But, yeah, I think once, and then I remember just, you know, going down to the school, and then it's a whole, you know, a whole different type of setup, too, because there you have a little more freedom as opposed to boot camp, where everything's very regimented. You know, they still, you know, have, you know, reveille at a certain time, dinner at a certain time, things like that, but, you know, now you're in school, and that's your job, so you're there to learn, and so that was it.
So you learned all about fire control, the electronics, and how long did that take?
Oh my God, I have it written down somewhere, but I'm really not 100% sure on the exact time.
Okay, so we'll say well into 1966 then?
Oh yes, definitely.
Okay, all right. And I just wanted to have you show this. You called this a Dixie cup?
Yeah, they call this the Dixie cup. This is one of the hats that they issued. Uh-huh. In boot camp, actually, and one of the things they had you do in boot camp was stencil all your clothes. So basically, you were given a stencil and a paintbrush, and you had to stencil all your clothing within a certain length of time. And they didn't give you much time to do it in. And so, if it was a piece of white uniform, you had black paint. If you had the navy blue dress uniform, you had to use white paint. And this is paint.
That's paint, and that is your serial number?
And that's my serial number, right.
Wow.
And that's something you never forget.
Uh-huh.
So it was 919-9248, and it was drilled into your head.
Mm-hmm.
And so, but now I think they use social security numbers, so they...
Ooh, yeah, that's a little dangerous.
Yeah, I know. That's what they did.
All right. So it's sometime in 1966. You're now in Maryland. You
right.
just finished fire control school.
Right.
Tell us what happened next.
Well, again, they give you a little time off, and then they ship you to a ship. And so I ended up getting the USS LaSalle out of Norfolk, Virginia.
And what type of ship was the LaSalle?
LaSalle was an amphibious transport dock. It was called an LPD. Basically, it's a landing platform dock. We used to refer it to as a large plastic duck, but because it was had a flat bottom to it, and it tended to kind of like roll in the ocean rather than just, you know,
you can just
float
show
through
this.
It.
This is the seal.
This is the patch for the LaSalle, and it was the... Latin is Facilitas Ad Marum, which basically is Latin for
And this is the ship itself?
Yes.
Okay, if you could just hold those up.
Okay. And
Okay, yeah, we can see it's flat.
Yeah, it definitely had a flat bottom. Mm-hmm. And the thing about the LaSalle, which one of the things, the first thing I noticed was it was huge, I thought, you know, coming down into Norfolk and seeing the thing tied up at pier. You know, and you go, wow, that thing's an enormous ship. And then you find out once it's in the ocean, it doesn't seem as big. It seems to shrink a little. But the thing with the LaSalle, it was able to land helicopters on the deck. It could land two helicopters at the same time. And also it had a gate in the back of the ship that could fall down or drop down, and they could run boats in and out of the bottom of the back of the ship. So that basically since it was an amphibious ship, it would transport Marines to certain areas, and this was the nature of the ship, that they would basically stay off the coast and then have like the troops land by the ocean in small boats and by helicopters.
So when were you officially assigned to LaSalle, and can you tell us about your first days upon this huge ship?
Well, it took a little bit getting used to because I thought it was so big. And then, you know, they basically give you the grand tour, and they told you, you know, where your berthing compartment was, which again, like I say, was up near the front of the part of the ship, the forecastle, or right underneath it anyway. And then they told, you know, they give you the tour as to what your duty stations were, where the mess deck was, things like that.
And you said that your berth, what was the berths like?
Were
you like stacked up?
Oh, yes, mm-hmm. yes. We had bunks that were three high. I had the bottom bunk. I think that was my preference, actually. I figured since the ship was always moving, if I were going to fall out of the bunk, I didn't want to fall too far. And so, but there were, you know, it was interesting.
Did you get seasick on your first?
There were not really seasick. I felt queasy.
Queasy.
And you
mm-hmm.
always felt that it seemed like the first day you were going anywhere. So at least I did anyway. Mm-hmm. But there were some people that were definitely getting seriously seasick, and it was kind of difficult for them to kind of like get adjusted to what was going on after, you know. But what mm-hmm. the way I felt was after the first day, then I was kind of like acclimated to whatever the ship was doing, and no matter how bad it was, and it was okay.
So at this point, did you feel that your training was adequate?
Well, again, that was one of the good things about the service. They sent you to school again for the specific systems that were on the ship. So in other words, basically Fire Control Technician A school was the general overall picture of electronics, electricity, and radar. And then once you went to the ship, depending on what type of systems were on board, you would go to those schools also, which I also have, and that was for the training center at the fleet anti-air warcraft
mm-hmm.
fleet
anti-air warcraft
warfare training center in Dammneck, Virginia.
Uh-huh.
And so that was where you went to school for the individual systems on the ship.
Did you have specific duties on the LaSalle?
Yes, basically you were in charge of a system. So in other words, you had to maintain it and operate it, you know, in the case of an attack or anything like that. So there were manuals that you had to run tests on the system every day. Certain things that you had to do specifically for that system, and test it and make sure that the outcome was what was supposed to come out. And if it didn't, then you would have to troubleshoot any kind of electronic problem. One of the things I remember was that there was a computer on board. Now this goes back well before
uh-huh.
digital computers. So we had a computer that was actually a mechanical electrical computer. it had like sliding levers and gears, and you had to like input information into it manually, which was kind of interesting considering
right.
the computers nowadays. I mean, your cell phone has probably more computing power than that system did back then. But it was kind of interesting to be able to, you know, at least see that and operate it at the time anyway.
So that was like the first generation electronic? Maybe second generation?
Probably second, yeah. Okay. I think that was, yeah, definitely, because like I say, it was all electromechanical and manual. So you mm-hmm. had to input, like say, like the speed of the ship, they would give you that information. And some of the things that like the yaw and the roll and things like that, it would be kind of input automatically, but you could still see the gears
right.
and the levers moving back and forth in the thing.
And what was your rank at the time?
When I left, I was a fire control technician third class. I actually had passed the exam for the next level, but if you don't have enough time mm-hmm. left in service, you can't have that rank. So basically, I didn't have enough time in the service to.
And you told me before the interview that the LaSalle basically served in the Atlantic.
Correct. The ship was the flagship for the Amphibious Forces Atlantic Fleet, so which meant that there was an admiral attached to the ship. He was like the commander for the whole Atlantic Fleet Amphibious Forces. As a matter of fact, I think it was actually Senator McCain's father that was the admiral, at one time anyway. So once in a while he would show up and come on board, and we would either do some maneuvers, and they would always have different types of events or things that they would take us out into the ocean and, you know, all these different ships, and they would do certain things, and then we'd head back to Norfolk. But the other thing about being the command ship for the Amphibious Forces Atlantic Fleet was that we were kind of like a PR ship also, because we went to New Orleans, Louisiana, and there was a Navy Day down there, and it was Tulane University. We ended up having a lot of the sailors off the ship march at the halftime show for, I think it was the Steelers and the Saints. So we did that. And
so
that was one of the things. We came up to New York City, and we also had like an open house there so that all the civilians that wanted to come on board and take a tour of the ship could do that. We ended up getting to New York City by going under the Verrazano Narrows Bridge. The ship was so tall, we had to lower part of the mast to do it. So, but that was kind of an interesting thing also. And then we did other events where we ended up going to Guantanamo Bay. We ended up picking up the Marines for some of these exercises that we had to do off of Morehead City. And then once all the Marines were on board, that's when we did all the exercises, you know, that the Navy had you do for fleet readiness and things like that.
Before the interview, you mentioned two incidents. Tell us about the collision.
Yes. Well, there was one day when I had the early morning watch, so I was in my bunk already. And all of a sudden, one of the guys said, hey, there's an alarm going off. And so I wake up out of the sound sleep, and you can hear the alarm going off. And it says, this is not a drill. This is not a drill. There's a collision. So I basically got out of my bunk, and I held on to a stanchion, which is a pole right near the bunk. And the ship kind of like moved a little to the side. And I said to the other guy, I said, well, what did we hit, a rowboat? You know, I mean, it must have been something really small. Well, little did I know at the time, it was a lot more serious than what we thought at the time. The two ships, the other one was an Israeli freighter, and came very close to hitting bow to bow. And if it did, I probably wouldn't be doing the interview today, because my berthing compartment was up in the front part of the ship. Mm-hmm. There was a hole that we found out later that was about 10 feet away from my bunk in the wall that they had to replace a big steel panel. As the ships went side by side down the port side, on our ship anyway, there was a motor whaleboat that usually hangs off the side of the ship, and there were guys that are supposed to be in there 24 hours a day just in case somebody falls overboard. Well, luckily these guys weren't in that little boat because it was kind of a miserable day, it was foggy, and they just felt, look it, let's just stay on the main part of the ship. We can always just jump onto the thing if something happens. Luckily, they were on the main part of the ship because as the other ship came by, it broke that thing in half. Half of it went into the ocean. The other half landed on that other ship. And so they, thank God, they were, you know, okay. And luckily, no one got hurt on either ship. So mm-hmm. that was one of the good things, too. But as the ships continued on their journey side by side, there was more damage along the catwalk on the far end of the ship also. And again, like I say, they just kept on going. They ended up in New York and we ended up in Norfolk, or as we pulled into Norfolk too, that was the other thing. The Admiral wasn't on the ship at the time. He was on waiting on the dock, which he wasn't, I guess, too happy about the whole situation. Mm-hmm. But as we were pulling into port, there was a fire in the galley.
Oh, dear.
So they had to announce that over the radio also. So when the alarm went off, everybody has to go to the general quarters stations, which is battle stations. And so I was up on the 04 level, which is up on the highest deck you can go on, basically. Like I say, we didn't know because, you know, we didn't see any of the damage. We were always inside the ship. We just basically ran from our berthing compartments or wherever we were to the top part, to our battle stations. So a lot of people were a little skittish about what was going on. And we didn't really know much until, like I say, we pulled into port and could see what damage there was and, you know, that happened to the ship. Basically, there was a hole in the bow that was probably about 18 feet wide. And then there were other holes along the side of the ship. So we ended up having to go into dry dock after that to fix all the damage.
Do you remember when that incident took place?
I don't exactly, but I have it somewhere on one of these little, I thought I had it on one of the little pieces of paper, but I guess I, oh, here it is.
Okay.
Oh, that's the capsule. Okay, this was in 1967.
Okay.
It looks like March 25th, I think, something like that. And it was in the Virginian Pilot. In the paper, and it says USS LaSalle, LPD-3, U.S. Israeli ship collides in 1967. And like I say, luckily no one was injured.
How long was the LaSalle in dry dock?
Oh, we were in there quite some time. It was probably, I think, 5 or 6 months, I think.
Were you given other duties while the LaSalle was in?
Well, basically, you still did the same thing that you know, your job. In other words, you had to still run all the tests on the equipment to make sure that it was up and running. You held watches that, you know, on the ship for either, like the officer of the deck would need, like a petty officer of the deck also, so that basically anybody coming and going onto the ship or off the ship would have to check in with either the officer of the deck or the petty officer of the deck, depending on who was in charge at the time. So yeah, you would definitely have your typical job that you would do, and then, you know, you would have watches also.
Okay, and I believe a year earlier, you had the little incident with the capsule.
Yes, well, that was an interesting thing because we ended up having people come on board from NASA and McDonnell Douglas, and they told us we were gonna go pick up a Gemini test capsule. And they were going to test the heat shield on the capsule, and so we went down to Ascension Island. So we ended up crossing the equator prior to going to the rendezvous spot, and that was one of a big event in the Navy. Crossing the equator is a rite of passage, I guess you could say, and so that was kind of an interesting thing. I have. The plan of the day actually on one of the pieces of paper, and it tells you what you have to wear because everything was very specific. If you were, if you had crossed the equator prior to this event, then you were a shellback. If you hadn't crossed the equator, you were considered a polywog. And so the shellbacks were basically in their uniform as, you know, typical, but the polywogs had to do all kinds of crazy things prior to crossing the equator, like put their, you know, uniforms on backwards, roll up your one leg of your pants. It was just, you know, but it was a traditional type of thing, and it was very interesting to go through that. So we ended up going through the, like I say, crossing the equator and going through the that event. And then when we went down near the Ascension Island, they shot the capsule up from Cape Kennedy, and in no time it went up, came down, and we picked it up. And it was, like I say, it was the Gemini test capsule. What we didn't know at the time was that it was not actually a NASA program, it was a US Air Force program. And it was actually considered, I think they had it like a MOL, which was a modular landing unit or something like that, or I'm not quite sure exactly what the what it was now. I have it somewhere. But the capsule was supposed to be a spy capsule, basically. They were going to send people up there, and then they were going to observe, obviously take pictures of whatever they're going to try, you know, pass over, and that was the event of it. But the thing was, later on, I was watching a NOVA program, and that's how I learned that it wasn't just a Gemini capsule that they're from NASA. It was actually, like I say, it was a U.S. Air Force program that they were trying to spy on the Russians. And the NOVA program was called Astro Spies, and it showed that not only did the U.S. have a program to send astronauts up in space to spy on Russia, the Russians had a program that was doing the exact same thing. Eventually, they disbanded both programs because they figured it was a lot easier just to send up a capsule unmanned, and they could take pictures and send the pictures digitally back down to Earth. So that's what they did, but before they did it, this was the first and only capsule that they sent up and tested. So they never really got the program off the ground.
And was this your first and perhaps closest encounter with the Cold War?
Well, yeah. I mean, I thought it was interesting. Like I say, at the time, we really weren't informed as to exactly, and obviously I can understand why, but the thing was, they just said, you know, because NASA was doing things also, having the astronauts go up and things like that. So, we had Mercury already, that had already happened, and then this was, like I say, a Gemini program. We just figured, okay, this is just another NASA program that, you know, they're going to just test it, and I can understand why. You know, they're just going to test the heat shield. But it was a little more than that. And actually, there was a patch, I think I had somewhere here, that this thing here. And it shows that the USS LaSalle, LPD-3, and it shows the space capsule in the background. And it says Titan 3C heat shield test, 1966. And it's the Helicopter Squadron 9, Detachment 80, that was the one that actually went out and put the flotation collar around it and picked it up and brought it back to the ship. And I also have, I think, somewhere in here. Oop, maybe not. I thought I had a photograph of us picking up the capsule, but maybe not. No, it must be in the other package over there. But I was going to say it's over there. Anyway.
Okay. So, 66, 67, the war in Vietnam's beginning to escalate.
Right.
Were you ever concerned that you might be sent over there?
Well, that was the strange thing about the whole thing. Actually, in boot camp, they asked you to fill out a dream sheet. And a dream sheet was like, okay, what do you want to do after boot camp? And well, I knew I wanted to go to school, and I knew they were going to send me to school. But the thing was, after, you know, going to the fleet, where were you going to go? So I put down, I want to go to the West Coast. I want to be on a destroyer. And I didn't get either one of those. So basically, I think the dream sheet was just a dream sheet. But a friend of mine was over in Vietnam on the USS Hancock. And so we corresponded a couple of times. And for him, he said it wasn't that bad. He said, first of all, he was on an aircraft carrier. He's off the coast probably at least 20 miles. All the events that were taking place were basically the planes taking off and landing every day. So for him, it wasn't that bad of a cruise, you know. And the strange thing about it was, I never really thought about it too often. Obviously, I knew there were people over there, you know, in harm's way and things like that. My brother-in-law was over there. But it seemed like you were there on your ship, you had a job to do, and that's what you did. And if they sent you over there, they sent you over there. And there was always the rumor going around that, oh, the LaSalle's going to Vietnam. And I'm going, well, yeah, if it goes, it goes. I mean, you know, you're on it, you're going with it, you know?
So, right.
I mean, it was like, it didn't really seem to be, you know, that big of a deal. You know, I figured if it went, it went. That was it.
And did you ever pay attention to media reports about Vietnam?
Not really. More so afterwards when I got out, you know, then, you know, because it was like, I was lucky enough to get out early because I ended up going to college afterwards. And so they let me out, I don't know, I think it was 3 months early. And once you go into college, once you're at college, there were a lot of, you know, anti-war protesters, you know, and some were, you know, definitely, you know, involved wholeheartedly in the anti-war program. And I didn't feel anything, you know, I didn't think there was anything wrong with that. And then there were others that were involved in it, kind of like, oh yeah, I want some time off, I'm just gonna be away from school and, you know, go to a protest meeting or something like that, or event. So, yeah, it was kind of a strange thing to be in, you know, I didn't get involved in either, you know, anti-war protests or anything like that, but, so it was kind of a different situation.
All right, let's just kind of reel it back a little bit, get you back on the LaSalle.
Sure.
Toward the end of your tour.
Yes.
Were you ever given R&R?
Oh, definitely, yeah. We always had R&R on the show. We ended up, we went to some interesting places. We ended up going to, we ended up going to Guantanamo Bay. Mm-hmm. Not exactly the best place for R&R. Mm-hmm. I think the only thing you saw there was the barbed wire fence around the place, and there was a swimming pool there that for mm-hmm. enlisted men and an enlisted men's club also. But other than that, not much to really see or do there. Mm-hmm. But we did go to some nice places. We ended up going to St. Thomas. We stopped there. We stopped at Bermuda and for a little bit. And again, like I said, you know, New York was always a nice spot to visit when we were there also.
So where and when were you discharged?
Norfolk, Virginia. Mm-hmm. And it was, I think it was June 6th, 1968. And I think that was Robert Kennedy's, yeah, because I remember when I was coming home, and it was kind of a strange situation. It really was strange because I was at Port Authority in New York, and they had the paper there that Robert Kennedy was assassinated. And I heard somebody say, well, he deserves it, or something like that. And I was like, I just couldn't believe that I heard that, for one thing. But obviously some people didn't care for the Kennedys, but I just thought that was kind of a horrible thing to say. Yeah, but that was a strange event as you were going through the, mm-hmm. you know, a large place like that.
Okay. And what was your rank?
It was a fire control technician, petty officer third class.
Petty officer third. And you mentioned you went to college.
Yes.
Where did you enroll?
Northeastern University.
And what was your major?
Criminal justice.
Was that partly influenced by your time in the Navy?
Not really. I'm not really quite sure how that came about, to tell you the truth. I just, I mean, there were a lot of, you know, strange things where had I stuck with what I had learned in the service, which was electronics and electricity, I could have probably ended up going into the same thing, you know, getting a bachelor's in electronics or engineering or whatever, something like that.
And go back to Maynard and work for Digital.
And go back to Maynard and work for Digital. But yeah, it was, that was kind of a strange series of events. I'm not quite sure why. I don't know whether it was my upbringing of watching, you know, Hoplon Cassidy maybe and the Lone Ranger, God knows. Uh-huh. I mean, it seemed like, you know, always the good guys, you know, and so you're trying to do something nice or good for the world. Yeah. But anyway, but one of the things I failed to mention was the fact in when I was in A school in Maryland, they had asked a few of us if we wanted to take a battery of exams to go to the Naval Academy Prep School. And again, I made a bad decision and decided, no, I didn't want to do that, because if I had gone to the prep school, supposedly, this is what someone told me, that once you graduated the prep school, you would go to, obviously, the Naval Academy. And once you went to the Naval Academy, then you would have to have another 10 years of service. And I'm thinking, well, I didn't really want to have 10 years of service, so I said no. And looking back at it, I'm thinking, probably not the smartest move I've ever made, but it was a move I made.
Okay. But, so Northeastern Criminal Justice.
Yes.
And of course, now this is later, 68 into 69, you mentioned the anti-war protesters.
Right.
Let's see, did you graduate from Northeastern?
Yes.
And did you get help from the GI Bill?
Yes, yeah, that was one of the things that definitely helped me, because my parents, you know, they weren't, you know, big wage earners, so that they could afford sending me to college. So luckily, the GI Bill helped quite a bit.
Mm-hmm. And what did you do with the A degree?
Well, I worked in the police field for a while. I had a few jobs. I worked law enforcement, then I worked for the federal government for a while, and I worked for a large telecommunications company for a while also. So a little bit of everything.
Now, over the years, do you believe that the attitude toward Vietnam veterans have changed?
I think, yes, I think mm-hmm. they definitely have changed. I mean, the thing is, you know, the servicemen don't deserve some of the negative press and, you know, feelings that they were getting back then. You know, I mean, it wasn't, you know, they didn't start the war. They were just there and doing the best they could. Mm-hmm. So I think that, I think that there was definitely negative an attitude toward a lot of the servicemen, which they didn't deserve. And I think nowadays maybe it's coming around that, hey, look, it wasn't their fault.
Russ, have you had a chance to visit the Vietnam Memorial in Washington, D.C.?
No, I haven't.
Or Moving Wall?
I did. I did see the Moving Wall. I think I saw it in, was it Halston, maybe?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it was quite the thing to see.
Okay. And so you moved to Natick about 30 years ago, was it?
30-something years
mm-hmm.
ago, right.
Why Natick?
Well, actually, my wife's family was from Natick, so we ended up in her mother's. Her mother had grown up in this house, and so we ended up getting into that house and living there for the 30 years.
Oh, what was the wife's
the
family name? The Shays. Okay.
Yeah. Helen and Walter Shay, or Walter Parker rather.
Oh.
Helen Shay
mm-hmm.
and all her brothers.
Yep, and the family.
And the family house.
Yeah, the family house, and I was just mentioning the Veterans Square that was dedicated a few years ago.
Yes,
yes.
All the relatives, yes, that mm-hmm. was a big event there. And everybody.
Huge.
Yes, that was mm-hmm. nice. That was very nice. Helen really appreciated that.
Uh-huh.
I mean, that was a big thing for her to have her brothers and sister, you know, mm-hmm. Mentioned on that.
And I think Esther is still the only woman vet on it so far. Yeah.
Oh, really? Oh.
I think so.
Oh.
I think so. Alrighty. So, your father too. Either of your children enter the military?
No.
And is there anything else you want to say? How important was it for you to serve in the military?
I think it was very important. I mean, I think I learned a lot. Just about myself, about the country, the world. I have a feeling, at least from the way I look at it, that I think that the United States should probably adopt the same type of a program that Israel has, where everybody has to serve either in the military or something with the government. In other words, I had a friend that was a conscientious objector. Now, I don't know whether he, did anything for the country. I'm hoping he did. But I've read a story about this one conscientious objector who actually ended up getting the Medal of Honor, which was kind of a strange thing. He refused to carry a gun during World War II. He was shipped over to Japan and fought over there. He didn't really fight. He was in the medical corps. But because of his actions, he ended up getting the Medal of Honor. And it was, the guy's name was Desmond Doss. It was an amazing story. Again, I saw it on a military channel. And I think he's the only person that ever was a conscientious objector and got the Medal of Honor. So I thought it was
something amazing.
Else. Yeah, definitely.
Okay. Anything else? Any other stories that come to mind?
Not really. I can't really think of anything else that...
Okay, well, Russ Lattuca, we thank you so much for coming down and taking part in the Natick Veterans Oral History Project.
Well, thank you very much. Okay. I really appreciate it.
Yeah.